Amen. Praise the Lord. I believe Roger and his team needs another round of applause. I just caught him. Amen. You know, I just called him last night to sub in tonight, today, so praise the Lord. Just imagine if it was you. Praise the Lord. So thank God for this team that the Lord has given us and the ability. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Good to be in the house of the Lord. Amen. Amen. Thank you for your kind giving. We appreciate each one of you and the way that you support us as your pastoral team. We've really been blessed in our life by being here and being where God has called us to be. It's good to have Mickey and Kathy back with us. Amen. Amen. I'm going to ask Brother Ken Williams if he would stand and ask the Lord to bless the remainder of the service.
Would you?
Amen. Praise the Lord. I also want to thank Sister Shelley for her Sunday school lesson. Every week, the Lord uses her to help me, and I appreciate everything she does. When she began to talk about preparing, I got a little chuckled, and I reached over and showed Jeff my notes that I had already prepared for this morning. And I want to share what I feel the Lord's laid on my heart, a couple of scriptures that kept rolling over in my mind. And hopefully you will be blessed by these scriptures. How many want to be a strong Christian? Amen. Amen. I don't know about you, but if I'm going to be a Christian, I want to be the best that I can be. Right? Whatever that you do, I hope that you strive to be the best. Now, I know there are sluggards in this world and people who don't really put their all into things, but I believe in being sold out for the cause which I commit myself to. Amen? How about you? Amen? And so what that entails is if God wants me to do something, then I'll do it. And if God wants me not to do something, then I won't do it. Right? Like if, well, the Lord wanted me to go over here and cuff Jesse upside the head and say, straighten up. I'll do it. If the Lord tells me not to do it, then I won't do it, which I don't think I should do it this morning because he's doing good. Praise the Lord. But whatever that the Lord inspires you to do, of course, and tells you to do, then that's the way that you should be in your life. You should be fully committed to follow the Spirit in everything, in every aspect, whatever it is. And there are no limits to what God can call you to. I was looking at something that was posted by a minister, and he referenced my uncle's church that I went to back in the 70s. My uncle pastored a church for many years, and there were many ministers that came out of that church. And this little church, it didn't seem to be much, but it sowed into people so that they could go out. And this minister said from Whitehaven, which is the name of that little church, and my uncle had let this young man preach on Sunday nights and fill in every once in a while, from Whitehaven to 66 nations around the world this man had preached in. So I want to tell you, whatever that your hand finds to do, you need to do it with all your might. And after you've done everything that you can do, the Lord will step in there and he will help you to stand even when it seems impossible to stand. Amen. Amen. So I think all of us would want to be stronger. I think all of us would want to be what we've been called to be. I think that all of us would want to be what the Lord would have us be. And I'm excited about what the Lord is making me still. Amen. God's not done with me. You may think that just because I've been a pastor for a while that God's, you know, assigned me to this and this is what I'm going to do for the rest of my life. I have no idea what tomorrow's going to bring, but I'm not worried about it. Because if he calls me, he will equip me. And if he equips me, then I'll be empowered by God to be exactly what he's called me to be. And I want to encourage you to take that same step of faith, or leap of faith for some of you, to follow the Lord, follow his recipe for success. And that's what the Bible is. The Bible is a recipe for success. If you want to be stronger, read the Bible. Read what God likes and what he doesn't like. And do what he likes and don't do what he hates. Right? I mean, if you can read something that the Lord hates and you can see yourself in those things, then extract yourself from there. Keep yourself from being jealous or running your mouth when you're not supposed to. Oh, I'm sorry. I'm back to the Wednesday night Bible study. This is a scripture, and what I do is I want a recipe for success that you can take into your own spiritual kitchen and whip up a life that's pleasing to God. Because I know that you would agree with me that there are lives that are pleasing to God, and then there are lives that are not pleasing to God. Sometimes we focus so much on what's wrong with everybody else that we refuse to address what's wrong with us. Sometimes we're so right in our own eyes that we can't see clearly to help everybody else. But what I believe is the Word of God that says, first, get your own act or eye cleaned out so that you can help everybody else. And so as we see recipes for success in the Scripture, that's what I want to share with you. Not one that I can do and you can't do, because I know that, Sister Shelley is a wonderful cook. I can't cook like she can, but I can go to the store and buy Cocoa Pebbles, right? And that's what a lot of people do in Christianity. You may not be able to live like the pastor, but what you do is you get down a cheaper, dumbed-down version that you just eke by, and that's not what God wants for you. And so I want everything that God has for you, I want it working in your life for your good and for the good of everybody around you. All of us say we want to be used by God, but when God says, jump, man, I don't feel like jumping. Right? And then God says, don't jump, and we said, oh, I feel like jumping. Why is it that we seem to want the exact opposite of what would make us stronger? Why is it that we are drawn to the things that actually hamstring us from being the best Christian or a Christian that we could be? I found this verse of Scripture just by happenstance, and I don't know if you've ever done it, but sometimes I just ask the Lord to, you know, lead me to what I need to be reading. And sometimes I'll open the Bible and I'll see what I need to say. Or I'll see what I need to be. Or I'll see what I need to do. Or I'll see what I don't need to do. Right? And so I opened up the Bible earlier this week, and this is the scripture that I'm going to share with you. It comes from 2 Chronicles, the 27th chapter. And this is it's basically an indescript man. His name is Jotham. And it says, so Jotham became mighty. And I thought, whoa. Now, if he can become mighty, maybe I can become mighty. And so what I wanted to do, Brother Ken, is look for the recipe of success for how did he become mighty. And so the scripture says, it's very plain, it says, because he prepared his ways before the Lord, his God. All right? So God had become a personal God, which impacted his way of life. And so what he did, he practiced what he was going to preach. A lot of us preach a Jesus who's able to deliver us from all kinds of things while we remain chained to the very things we say that he can deliver us from. Not you. Some people. Some people. I want every one of you to be a man or woman of God that's not ashamed of the gospel, that the gospel is the power of God, not only to salvation, but to the salvation of many, many others. And I believe that God is raising up a people in this very church who will do just that, who will walk in His way, will prepare their hearts to receive whatever it is that the Lord wants them to do. And you know what? We have seen people both stay and go, and I bless both. Amen. It used to be that when someone left, I would cry a river. And there are some people that have left that I still cry about a little bit. And what I mean by that is it hurts my heart that they're not with us, helping us grow. But you know what? We send them out and they are flavoring communities all around the globe. Amen. There is a saying, it's not how many, a church is not judged in success by how many it brings in, but how many it sends out. I like that. So if I can equip you for the harvest, the last day's harvest, to gather in souls for the Lord, to walk uprightly before God and this community, then that's exactly what I want you to do. Amen? I want you to be mighty. Turn to your neighbor and say, be mighty. Be mighty. Yeah. Unfortunately, some of you will stop at Mighty Mouse. Right? Now, that may date me. But I want you to prepare your ways before the Lord. And what that does, it gives some thought to how that I'm going to be. If God has called me to holiness, or if He's called me to righteousness, or if He's called me to be more than a conqueror, then how can I prepare my heart and my mind to receive what God has prepared for me? When I think about the scripture, I know you'll probably know the message of John the Baptist, which was an echo of the prophet Isaiah, which says, a voice crying in the wilderness. In Mark, the first chapter and the third verse, it says, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord, make His paths straight. And so as we talk about this today, and I know there are many different analogies that we could use, but if you think about a path, you think about something that has been worn out because other people have gone that way, right? Well, I want to tell you this. Sometimes, though, we're like trailblazers where we're cutting the path. And I'll tell you how I know this, because nobody has ever carried the gospel message of Jesus Christ into tomorrow. And so you tomorrow morning are going to wake up on a path that no one has ever walked. Right? And so you'll have to be a trailblazers, but there are paths of thought processes and ways of doing things that are going to be successful if you will embrace the Word of God, right? And so the scripture that kept on popping in my mind over and over again, I feel like I shared it not too long ago, but it comes from Proverbs, the 16th chapter, around the 7th verse, when the Bible says, when a man's ways please the Lord, he'll make his enemies to be at peace with him. Now, some of you would do well to enact that power in your life. Some of you are so beset by the enemy that a simple act of preparing your heart to the obedience of the Word of God by pleasing the Lord with what you do. Now, listen. You say, well, Brother Scott, that's a big thing. Well, I'm telling you, that's what we've been called to do. Called to be students of the Word. We're called to desire the sincere milk of the Word that we can grow thereby, so that we'll be teachers. We can be teachers, or we'll usher in the prophetic voice of the Spirit, or we'll walk in the Spirit and not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Don't tell me there's not a path. There's a path. Amen. Tried and true, and it's by being obedient to what God wants you to do. Amen, that rhymes. I'm a poet and I didn't know it. Amen. When someone's ways please the Lord. Now, I have a question for you. If you could have the victory right now over something in your life, if there's something that's been bothering you, dogging you around, plaguing you, and you seem like you just can't get loose from it, if you could be free today, would you be free? Would you be free? Would you be free? And so I'm asking a very particular question because some of us drag things around that we don't need to drag around. And I'm saying today, let it go. Amen. Let it go. If you want to prepare the Lord to bless you in your life, then you're going to have to walk in obedience. You're going to have to walk in the Spirit. You're going to have to walk in the authority of what God created you to be in the first place. Amen. It's spelled out. I look at this one scripture and I think of how the people of Christians are dogged around by the enemy so much. I think about how many troubles and trials and temptations that they all they don't get the victory over. They just suffer through. And I'm not talking about think it not strange when fiery trials come, because they're going to come. But I'm talking about being bogged down in those things that keep you from being what God, keep you from being mighty, keep you from being spiritual. I'm talking about those things. And I'm talking about putting your foot down on top of their head and amen. Now I'll tell you, okay. I'm not afraid of snakes. Now, if a snake struck at me quickly, I might dodge, right? Because I know that I have the power to put my heel down on the top of that snake's head, right? And I know that I can deal a fatal blow to that snake. Amen. Let it be so, right? Now, I let some snakes live because they're good snakes, and I'm talking about real snakes. I'm not talking about devilish snakes. In the physical, I am not afraid of snakes. That I might treat one with apprehension for the purpose of getting the drop on it. Right? And what I'm talking about is if you get a snake right behind the ears. Now listen, listen to me now. I've had snakes by the neck, choked them out. But you know what they'll try to do? Them constrictors will try to roll around that arm. And I've had one or two that I was wondering where the muscles in my arm were going to be strong enough to withstand this constriction. I'm just telling you a physical reality. This has physically happened to me. But praise God, I've got another hand. Amen. I've got another hand. And if that fails, I've got other weapons. Amen. Amen. Now listen, I don't know what you may be imagining right now, but I'm going to tell you, like a snake, the enemy desires to have his way in your life. But my desire and the will of God for you is for you to be successful and gifted in the Spirit so that you don't come behind in anything that God has to offer. And if that's you, then you can be a mighty man or woman of God even this morning. Amen. I believe it. Oh, well, two of you believe it. Thank you, Jesus. That's enough. It's enough. Amen. If I can get one of you to agree with me. Amen. This world is full of snakes and things that would keep you from being what God has created you to be. And when I say what God has created you to be, God has created you to be a mighty warrior in the spiritual family of God. He has. No ifs, ands, or buts. That's what he breathed the breath of life into man's nostrils to be, was to be someone that he could have a relationship with. And God wants a relationship with you. And he's called to you, and he's called to you, and he's called to you. And some of you have come, and I'm thankful for that. And I want you to be the best that you can possibly be. But some of you still will not come, because Jesus said, how often would I have gathered you in, but you would not? And I'm saying the same thing about sometimes walking in victory, is how often would God have given you the victory over these problems in your life, and you would not? Somebody wants me to start calling out sin. List them out. Now listen, it's the whole thing. It's the whole thing. It's the whole thing. I don't know if you're probably familiar with David's approach to some of these things. And what he said is, Lord, purge me and I'll be clean, right? You purge me, right? And I'll be clean. He said, forgive me for things that I may have omitted that are pleasing to you. And forgive me from presumptuous sin. And forgive me for the things that I have done, both against myself and against others and against you, God. Hey, sounds like a recipe for success, right? What's God's heart want? He wants a relationship with you where that you can commune with him, and where he can walk you through both your failures and your successes through the grace and mercy that he's provided. Because it's by his grace and mercy that we're not consumed. If God wanted to consume you, he would have already done it. But he wants to save you, and he wants to strengthen you, and he wants to empower you, every one of you. Could you imagine what this church could do if every single person in this room could be described as mighty men and women of God? Amen. If all of us would begin to walk and walk before the Lord in integrity and honesty, God, you lead me and I'll go. Speak to me and I'll repeat it. I would like you to follow along with me back up a chapter to the 15th chapter of Proverbs, where I love to give great context. Proverbs, the book of wisdom, 15th chapter, around the 24th verse, it starts, it says, the way of life is above to the wise, that he may depart from the hell beneath. Oh, I don't even like to use the word hell. Okay, not because I'm afraid to teach on hell, because hell's real, right? I just don't like to use the word because so many people have used it as a byword that I don't want to be accused of using it as a byword. You hear me? You hear me? Do you hear me? Now, this is scripture. This is scripture. The way of life is above to the wise, that he may depart from the hell beneath. Let me tell you something. Nobody's getting out of hell. Now, you may have believed some kind of funky purgatory doctrine that ain't coming from this pulpit. Listen, you may believe you can buy another candle or give another offering and get your grandpa out of hell. It ain't gonna happen. I'm sorry to be the bearer of that news. But what I'm telling you is that in this life, you don't have to go through some of the hell that you're going through. Nobody's getting out of hell, but this scripture says that we can depart from the hell beneath. Now, of course, it could be escape the penalty of a devil's burning hell. And I hope that for every single one of us. And I hope that for you today. I hope that for every single one of us, that you'll claim the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. That you'll give your heart, that you'll surrender your heart, mind, and body to him. I pray that in Jesus' name. Right? But I can't do that for you. Neither can I prepare your way. I can tell you to prepare your way. I can tell you to prepare your heart. I can tell you to prepare your mind, but you've got to do it. You've got to do it. It doesn't end there. It says the Lord will destroy the house of the proud. You ever met anybody proud in the church house? It seems to be a religious person. Yep, got their nose stuck up, can't deal with anybody. Nobody can deal with them. Right? Now tell me the truth. Have you seen it in the church? Yeah, they're playing in the shallow end of the pool. I'll tell you that much. Seeming to be deep. Like an adult with floaties. Now, how silly would that look? Right? I'm telling you the truth. It's church work every single day. Adults with floaties. That's a good message, Manny. You should mark that down, and maybe you could take it up, share the rest of that. The Lord will destroy the house of the proud, but he will establish the border of the widow. Now, listen, I don't know what is more a widow comes into view in the scripture, the purest of religion is for the church to take care of the orphan and the widow, somebody that doesn't have a mother or father, and also a woman that doesn't have a husband through death. And so that looks like they need help from the church because it's a weakened position, right? In the physical, it looks like a weakened position. But in the spiritual, how would you like to be established by the Lord? Amen. Oh, I thank God for all the praying mothers that have kept going and kept the fire burning for their lost sons and daughters. I thank God for all the praying mothers that don't know how that it's going to work out, but trust God that it is going to work out. I thank God for all the praying mothers. Amen. Come on now. Give the Lord praise and glory. Amen. He will. This is when a man's ways please the Lord. He will. The thoughts of the wicked are an abomination to the Lord. You got to get your mind right. But the words of the pure are pleasant words. Now that makes a distinction from wicked people and pure people. Right? Now, if nobody's pure, there are no pleasant words. But we know that the purity that comes from the Lord and what he can do, the cleansing power, the blood of the Lamb, that brings forth words that are pleasant. He that is greedy of gain troubleth his own house, but he that hateth gifts shall live. The heart of the righteous studieth to answer, but the mouth of the wicked poureth out evil things. Wednesday night, we were talking about how to be swift to hear and slow to speak because your mouth will get away from you before you know it, right? And it'll just be pouring out things that it shouldn't be pouring out. So if you were to take this one scripture and think about how to, and I know some of you do, and I thank God for it, because it does cut down and it cuts a lot of contention out of the church. Because if I said everything that I wanted to say in the flesh, that there'd be some ears laying on the floor. There'd need to be some healing in the house. Jesus would have to come through and fix you up. Right? Okay. The heart of the righteous studieth to answer, but the mouth of the wicked poureth out evil things. The Lord is far from the wicked, but he heareth the prayer of the righteous. A lot of people get confused when the scripture says the Lord is no respecter of persons. But this scripture tells you that there are two paths that people are on in this world, and one is far from the Lord, and one, you're so close that he can hear your prayer. The light of the eyes rejoices the heart, and a good report maketh the bones fat. The ear that heareth the reproof of life abideth among the wise. He that refuseth instruction despiseth his own soul, but he that heareth reproof getteth understanding. The fear of the Lord is the instruction of wisdom, and before honor and humility. If you go right on to the 16th chapter, roll right on, it says, the preparation of the heart of man and the answer of the tongue is from the Lord. All the ways of a man are clean in his own eyes, but the Lord weighs the spirits. Commit thy works unto the Lord, and thy thoughts shall be established. Now, I wanted to get here for a purpose, because a lot of times, Sister Shelley, what we're doing is we're looking in the Word for something to do, right? We're looking in the Word for something to do, something that we can do, something that we can do. And the Word will tell you things that are right and things that are wrong. And so when we do those things, you commit thy works unto the Lord, and thy thoughts shall be established. We do the exact opposite. We've got to think of something to do, right? We've got to think of something to do, but what we need to do, the recipe for success has already been given to us. We don't need to think of another way. We've got a way. We don't need to think of another truth. We've got a truth. We don't need to think of another Savior. We have a Savior. We don't need another word. We've got the word. We don't need another spirit. We've got the spirit. We don't need another truth. We've got the truth. Amen. Amen. Commit thy works unto the Lord, and thy thoughts shall be established. This tells me to start doing what the word tells you to do, and then the mind will be regenerated from the outside in. Huh. We've got it backwards. We need to think of something and then do it. But the Lord's saying, do it, and I'll establish the thoughts in your mind. Why? Because when a person's ways please the Lord. And so he's no respecter of persons, where he's saying, oh, I'm going to make this one better than that one. No, in the same house there's many vessels. And the Bible says, if you'll purge yourself from the works of iniquity, you can be a vessel of honor. And that's what I want you to do, is be a vessel of honor, mighty in the sight of God. Amen. Whoa, you mean someone in the Old Testament that did not have the indwelling of the Spirit could be described as a mighty man because he did something? Now we who have the Spirit, are you saying we now cannot walk by faith and not by sight? It's exactly what we do, and we trip ourselves up and we stumble around like people who have no light. And I'm telling you, arise and shine, for the light has come. And the glory of the Lord, of course, has risen. Amen. Amen. And it's done so for each and every one of you, that you can be a man or woman of God that could be described as mighty. I'll leave this building today and go directly to a memorial. Of a man that should be here this morning. You never know. You never know. You say, well, one day my ways are going to please the Lord. One day I'm going to start reading the Bible. One day I'm going to start coming to church. One day I'm going to be faithful with everything that the Lord gives me. One day, today is the day of salvation. Today's that day. Amen. Today is that day. Amen. Stand with me if you would. Amen. 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 If you never accepted the Lord as your Savior, I'm talking about the truth of life. The only real thing is the truth. It's found in God's Word. And by His Spirit will make it come alive in your life. And if you've never given your heart to the Lord in that manner, today's the day. Praise the Lord. And right where you're at, the admission of guilt, the profession of faith can save your soul. And that's the difference that's being made. Would you bow your heads this morning? Heavenly Father, I love you today. I thank you for this opportunity to be a bearer of your word. Lord, I pray that you would help us each and every one to be stronger than we are today, tomorrow. I pray that you would saturate our thoughts and hearts with your thoughts and with what pleases your heart. Help us to avoid everything that you don't like and to embrace everything that you do. Lord, and we'll give you the praise and glory for the victory that we know will come in Jesus' precious name. Amen and amen. Shake somebody's hand. Let them know you love them today. God bless you. God bless you is my prayer. Thank you, Jesus.